Good morning, viewers. Once again, namaste from the incredible India. We are bringing to you the 40th webinar as part of the Dekho Apna Desh webinar series. And thank you so much for all the overwhelming support that you've been giving us. This week, because the lockdown has started easing out and a lot of us are back to physically being in our offices and also getting engaged with a lot of other activities, we thought we'd take back to doing only Saturdays. And we are extremely happy that in this period, you actually send in a lot of queries that where were we on Tuesdays and Thursdays? Well, we were all working from office, but that's the healthy and getting back to normal norm. So we will keep bringing to you many more webinars as we go along. And if you really, really want us to go back to doing some on weekdays, we shall be happy to host. It's your incredible India, and we shall keep showcasing that to you. Today, what we are bringing to you is something a little different, a little offbeat, but something that is so much a part of us, the women of India. And what are the women of India doing today? They are going motorcycling. Now, that's a stereotype deconstruct, because for a lot of us, women have been on cycles, but women motorcycling is something, you know, you sort of think about it. But all it requires is a little imagination, little stepping out of the box and going and doing that extra mile for something that you have a passion for. And two incredible women from Incredible India today, bringing the session to you is Ms. Jay Bharti. Ms. Jay Bharti, incidentally, is otherwise an architect by profession and by education too. And this is something that is her passion on the side. And she is driven all the way from Telangana to Burma. But she's going to tell you a lot more about other travels of hers too. And joining her is a very young, I in fact asked her, I said, are you in high school? She said, no, I've been writing for 13 years. So she's been writing for 13 years. Before that, she was working in the finance world and has done so many miles. I can't believe it. She has done more than 30,000 miles already. And she blogs, she writes, she has more than 1 million followers. So she is another incredible woman of our incredible India. And I'm not going to stand in between the two of them and all of you. So I'm going to ask Jay Bharti to please come on the web stage, riding on her bike and taking us meandering all along our beautiful country. Jay. You need to unmute yourself. Sorry.
Good morning, everyone. I hope it's clear enough.
Yes,
I'm signing in. Thank you. So I'm signing in from Telangana, and I'm the only woman from Telangana having done more than 1 lakh kilometers across 7 countries, because somehow I grew up with love for two wheels, and wherever I go, I just take my two wheels and go. And, you know, the passion has overtaken my profession, and now I run a foundation where we teach women how to ride two wheelers. That's a little bit about me. And I'm very glad that, you know, Ministry of Tourism has picked up. So when I suggested, why can't we do a webinar on motorcycle trips? So they said, you know, we have so many of you women riding motorcycles in our country. Why not we do an exclusive women motorcyclist tour, I mean, a webinar. So I was really very excited. And Ministry has earlier supported us in one of the trips where we went all the way from Telangana until Vietnam, covering 5 countries and 17,000 kilometers. So, you know, with you people supporting us, we will definitely be doing more and more wherever we go. Today, I'm very happy that I'm sharing space along with another incredible women biker we have in India, Candida. So both of us will... you know, both of us actually are very outdoor kind of people. For us, it's very difficult to get onto this virtual stage and share so many things. We'll try to do as best as possible. So I hope you'll, you know, let us be as free. So the screen, what you see is a bunch of us. Of course, there are thousands more than whatever just there on the photograph. But this is a picture at Qutub Shahi Tombs. So we as bikers, whenever we travel, we prefer to, you know, take a big group picture alongside a monument to showcase that we are Indian women. So that's all about it. And So this is me, India, Myanmar, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam, and most recent trip was across USA. I did a 10,800 mile trip across the USA, and my fascination is traveling to UNESCO sites wherever I go. In India, I've visited all the UNESCO sites in the year 2012 when I won a challenge, and continue to visit the UNESCO sites wherever I go. So the minute I make any map, the route will be through the UNESCO sites, irrespective of whether it's just a travel trip or a motorcycle trip. Then I also prefer doing a lot of group tours. I run a female-only motorcycle club called Bikerni. I run the Hyderabad chapter. And I like to, you know, encourage more women and take them on bigger tours. I also wrote a book on my Road to Mekong experiences. This is more like a travelogue, you know, what led into us women planning for such kind of an extraordinary trip and how did we successfully do it without an accident or an incident. So that's a big takeaway, but we just did that. And now I'll leave it to Candida to take over.
Thank you, Jay. A very good morning to all of you. So I'm Candida Lewis, and I'm currently in Hubli, Karnataka. So I've been riding a motorcycle for the last 13 years, but my two biggest motorcycle rides have been the first one in 2015, where I rode across India, covering 22 states and 32,000 kilometers. It took me 7 months, where I rode through slowly and really experienced and loved every bit of our country. And then I started leading motorcycle tours in 7 different countries. And I've led almost 40 trips so far. And my recent big ride has been riding from India to Australia, where I rode through 10 different countries. And this ride took me 8 months to complete. So basically my interests are leading motorcycle tours and basically showing what people from abroad, what a beautiful country we have. So I lead motorcycle tours in India, basically for foreigners. And I take Indian people to different countries to see other countries on a motorcycle. And yeah, I basically like experiencing local cultures and cuisines. I love interacting with the locals and just being in the moment and having fun. And I also do a lot of volunteering and community service. So I've ridden in Cambodia, and where we helped build a school, helped teach children English. And also when I'm back in India, we train a lot of women how to ride motorcycles so that more women can be independent and explore our country.
This is Urvashi Patole, co-founder of the Bikerni. Over the years, ever since Bikerni was founded in 2011, we have seen an entire growth and revolution of women bikers in India. Right from 11 of us being the first group of women to riding to Khardungla, to women today riding from Hyderabad to China, or from Bangalore to Australia, and completing so many kilometers across India. It's amazing. Women are now stunting, they're racing, they have started their own training schools to teach other women to ride, and enabling businesses and opportunities for them. It's been a long and beautiful journey. We are still evolving and trying to create an equal platform for women motorcyclists across India. And it's great to see that Bikerni has been able to inspire so many more women to ride.
Hello everyone, I am Anita Krishnan. I head the India division for the Women's International Motorcycling Association. And I had this great opportunity to be a part of the Women Riders World Relay that happened last year. I'm here to share a story from the WRWR India leg, because I had this opportunity to get the baton at the Wagah border and start the relay basically. So this relay started somewhere in Scotland, and the baton went all around the world, and through Pakistan it came to India. So we had an opportunity to get the baton from Pakistan at the Wagah border, and then further pass it on to Nepal, our neighboring country. So we had the relay going on for about 15 days in India, covering a little bit of the northern part of India. Now, the good thing is that we got to give it to Nepal, but we also got to get it back from Nepal to pass it on to Bangladesh. So we further had about 5 days of the relay in the northeast part of India. Now, this relay got a lot of riders from all over the world to India. And we also connected with a lot of women riders globally. And just to see the strength of women riders in India and all across the globe was just an amazing feeling. And, you know, this relay was something that just got us all together. And I think it just feels very good to be connected with so many women motorcyclists in India now. And also to see the kind of, you know, the courage that women show in India as far as motorcycling goes. So I hope that we do have many, many more events like these, you know, where which actually focuses on something that that empowers us women motorcyclists. So, yeah, thank you and cheers.
So, yeah, back.
Like Candida also mentioned and Rupinder ma'am has already spoken, India is bestowed with, you know, so many variations. Like in most of the countries, they might just be good for roads or just for beaches. But in India, we have a mixture of everything. So right from heritage and culture, like I said, back in 2012, when I traveled across India, there were 28 UNESCO sites. But today we have 38 UNESCO sites spread across each and every corner of the country. And it's not just about these 38 UNESCO sites, but apart from that, we have million other monuments to be explored in India. If you're, you know, a history buff or you want to know more about our heritage, there are monuments present in every state. And then it's also a mix of diverse culture. Like wherever you travel, you know, every state has a different culture and different cuisine. So that gives a very good mixture. And especially for foreigners traveling within India, they like to come to India to explore these diverse cultures. And motorcycle is a great way to, you know, just ride through the villages and experience these. And when it comes to the beaches, again, we have a huge coastal length of beaches, approximately about 7,500 kilometers, starting from the east to the west. And all the coastlines, there is extreme tourism facilities all through the coastline, be it in Calcutta, I mean, West Bengal or Orissa or Andhra Pradesh, again, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. So when the east side of the beach line gives you a different experience, it's very good during the winters. And even if you can go in summers as well, of course, it's a bit humid. But again, when you come back onto the western side of the coastline, especially during the mountains, it's a crazy ride, you know, riding through. And sometimes you just feel like some beaches along the western coast, you just feel like you're going along with the sea and you can just stop it anywhere, get onto the beach, spend some time and get back, get all dusty. That's one experience you can have riding a motorcycle. And the best part is the entire coastline is accessible all around the year. It's not like, you know, some places are closed. Like, you know, in some, when we go to the next section, which is the mountains and hills, some of the areas are, you know, not accessible during extreme winters or something like that. But beaches is all the year round. You know, you can just get onto your motorcycle. If you are, you know, a person who would love water and sea and oceans, just get on the motorcycle. And from anywhere in India, especially in the south, between 500 to 200 kilometers, you can easily reach out to any of the beaches and, you know, just lay down and enjoy. That's one good part. And coming to the mountains and hills, we, of course, have seven major mountains. But apart from that, there are, again, hills across the India. You know, you have so many Nilgiri, or you have the entire Western Ghats spreading all across Kerala, Karnataka and all. And all these mountains or hills, you know, test the adventure spirit in you. Of course, we have all been traveling for over a decade now, and all of us are 100% safe. There is nothing which will happen if you're riding into the motorcycles. You might see some pictures where, you know, particularly in this picture which I've shared, you can see that the rock might fall anytime, but you know, it doesn't fall like that. Of course, there are landslides, but there are people who will tell us that, okay, the road is not good ahead. Maybe you have to wait for 2-3 hours, but you can cross and go. So there is a adventure in itself, riding in the mountains or the hills. But end of the day, we will all be safe and fine when we take care of all the precautions what are needed. But it's really beautiful riding in the mountains and hills. It's a surreal experience, and we are very happy that, you know, in India we have so many mountains and hills to explore. And then comes the highways and countryside. I don't know if everybody knows, we second US in the ranking of the length of you know, road network. This, of course, the statistics is from 2017. I'm sure in the last 2 years we have seen much more development of road lengths, but we are excellently connected to the entire you know, country, be it the national highways or the state highways or the country roads. All of them now have you know, beautiful roads. And for riding a motorcycle, of course, sometimes we like riding in the mountains and hills, but for you to go from one place to even a mountain, you need a proper road to approach. So, you know, again, we do have beautiful highways where we can, you know, actually cover 400 to 500 kilometers easily in a day without getting tired at all. And again, like all of you know, every state has beautiful countryside. When you come to the south and even in states like Punjab, you know, it's rich, especially during this time, during the monsoon and all of the times, we have rich fields, rich paddy fields, or, you know, even the wheat fields or corn fields and sugarcane fields. And there are, you know, one slip road just goes through these fields. And when you're riding, if you put up a drone and see, sometimes we'll realize that, you know, we are somewhere just as a spot amidst these fields with our motorcycle. That's another thrill in itself. So, yeah, I'll leave it to Candida to take it over from here.
So, like Jay said, when I describe India to anyone that comes here, I always say that India is more like a continent because we have everything from beaches to snow mountains to deserts and even the white salt plains. So basically, India is so rich in culture and heritage and even natural landscapes. So I would like to start off with North India. North India is basically every biker's dream to visit, especially Ladakh, Spiti, and basically ride to the highest motorable pass in the world. Some may say Kardungla or even Umlingla, but North India has some of the best mountain ranges across the world, and that's why a lot of bikers make this their dream to come and visit. Also, the to ride to Kargil and some of the war memorials are basically a must visit for every biker, and also to stay with the army camps and just experience what the Indian Army is doing for our nation. Along with that, North India has a lot of heritage monuments across different parts. And since a lot of tourists and the biggest airport is in Delhi, it's just very convenient for people to rent out motorcycles and then do a ride across the loop of North India. So, which is why it's one of the most popular destinations. But what is very special for me riding through the valley is that all the children that keep on waving while we pass by, it's just a very special a feeling. It feels very welcomed to their area. And I don't think anyone could experience this on any other modes of transport. The experience that we get while riding a motorcycle is very different and very special. So that is all that I would like to say about the North India for me. The next slide would be East India. So I know a lot of you know about Calcutta and the rest of the normal places, but one thing that really stands out in the east of India is the Northeast, and the Seven Sisters of the Northeast have the most stunning destinations in India. It's a lot more less explored compared to North India and the rest of India. But I found riding through there had some of the most cleanest villages. The most special places that I visited were the Living Root Bridges, Kaziranga, the different kinds of waterfalls. I think I visited more than 20 waterfalls while I was there, but one special was the Rainbow Waterfalls. And basically all the high mountain passes, and so every state is so very different, so very rich in culture, and the cuisine changes according to the state wise as well. And I think there's no better way than exploring all these seven sisters than on a motorcycle, because the places are so remote that I think with a motorcycle you can easily and go around without any hassle, and you can just keep on stopping and taking pictures, and because it's so remote, like everyone that you pass by will always wave and invite you for a tea or just tell you their local stories, compared to like traveling by bus or stuff like that. So that is what I enjoy the most again in the northeast of India. So we'll move on to south. Okay, so South India for me is very special, is because this is where I live and this is where I started riding. So I started riding because of my dad, and because we used to go on these motorcycle trips when I was really young from Hubli to Goa, and that's really what the got the bug in me. And South India is blessed with like the best beaches. We are surrounded by water, so we have some of the best beaches, and some beaches are like less explored, and that's what I like going to the most. And apart from the beaches, Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka has so many temples, apart from the temples, again, there's so many different cuisines in all of these states, and people in South India are really, really friendly. And I think that's what gave me the confidence of riding across India, is because my parents learned to trust me and believe that I could take care of myself and ride across India, is because I started doing these trips around South India and I always came back safe. Even when I would not find a place to stay, local people would always welcome me into their homes. There was one incident when I landed up in Rameshwaram, and I really wanted to snorkel, and I went around to a couple of hotels asking them if they have the snorkeling service, but they all directed me to a local fisherman. And I went to this local fisherman, and he took me out into the sea, just him and me. We were out in the sea for 2 hours, and then we caught some fish. We came back home, his wife cooked for us, and then we took out water from the well and we just poured it on ourselves to wash all the salt from us. So these are just local experiences that I really cherish. And again, South India has made me trust people a lot of more, which has helped me open up my horizon a lot more. But yeah, that is just a little about South India. There's a lot more to see, a lot more to explore. Amazing pictures on the Incredible India page and all of that. So we'll move on to the next slide, which is West India. So, yeah, okay, thank you. So, West India, again, all these experiences that I'm sharing with you is from my 2015 solo ride across India. Very special ride, again, when I landed up in Pushkar. It opened up this whole different world to me. I never expected so many foreigners and such beautiful, colorful places. And my special place was Udaipur because I loved how the city is surrounded by water, all the hotels submerged in water. It was a really magical place, so to say, and I really loved it. Also, again, Rajasthan is so rich in its culture and heritage. And one special place for me was visiting the Biker Temple, also known as the Bullet Baba Temple. I don't know if a lot of you have heard about it, but every biker that passes through this route, make sure to stop over here and just look at this old Royal Enfield motorcycle in this glass case. And the story behind it is incredible. And that is why so many people go there every day to worship and just praise him. So I think that was one special place that I went to. And there's a lot more places that I never ever heard of. But while I was riding there, while I would stop and talk to the truck drivers, and just stop at all these different dabas, the truck drivers would tell me, go here, go there. And that is how I also landed up at the Rat Temple, the different forts. And also another incredible place is the desert, the sand dunes in Jaisalmer, and also the salt flats of Gujarat. I think a lot of bikers love riding there and like just taking these different poses with their motorcycles and like picking up their motorcycle, because you can do all of that and make your photos look really creative in the west of India. So incredible riding places again. So we'll move on to the next, that is Central India. So again, I was always scared of riding through the central part of India because for me, I do not have a lot of knowledge about Central India. Not a lot of people spoke about it. So I was really scared and I did not know what to expect when I was riding through the central of India. But I could simply say it's definitely the heart of the country. It's a very soft and mystical land with ancient temples, majestic forts, forests, jungles, waterfalls, wildlife, and it has some of the most vibrant and historical cities. And being there was still a little fear for me because of what I've grown up hearing. But I can say that a lot of people told me that there's going to be you would be robbed in the forest. There's a lot of dacoits and stuff like that. But I've never experienced any sort of stuff like that. I've ridden in the nights as well. So sometimes I would say that you need to trust the universe to protect you and they will guide you. And sometimes you just come across these brilliant places, just like the picture in this slideshow where I was just passing by and I suddenly looked and saw that these guys were washing their motorcycles and just jumping into this small little stream. And I just went and like took a cool picture and also spoke to them. So this is just another a good experience from exploring India. And now that all these slides have ended, I would like to say that a lot of people told me as well, do not ride around India alone. It's not safe. A lot of things will happen. But like I said earlier, that India is the most beautiful country. It's almost like a continent. There's so many different things that you could see and witness, and the hospitality of people is the most amazing compared to the rest of the world. So I encourage more women out there to go out and explore what a beautiful country has to offer. So you can continue, Jay. Thank you.
Thank you, Candida. I'm sure all of you would have enjoyed all her, of course, 1 hour is a very limited time for us to put our high resolution pictures, but you know, unlike me, Candida is a very social kind of a person, at least out there on the social media. She has beautiful videos which she captured all through her journeys, and she is if you just get to her YouTube or Instagram, you'd be able to see tons of content into this entire through all her journeys. So you know, so I'll try to move on. And like she said, most entire India, we have a diverse mix of, be it mountains, forests, landscapes, but also what forms a major thing for people to visit India or for us to even, you know, explore within the country is the culture. So, you know, I'm just going to explain one part of the culture from the state where I come from, Telangana. And like, I totally agree to what, Candida mentioned. Coming from South, we women have a lot of confidence, from the time growing up until now. Our parents have always been free of worry, and that really helped us boost our own self-confidence. Confident wasn't something we had to learn looking at someone, but it just got imbibed within us growing up in these places. And one part of the Telangana culture is the Batukama festival. It is a 9-day festival which happens during the Navratri. And the saying goes like, it's more than 800 years old. I don't know exactly, but the best part of this festival is, if you want to call something as, women empowerment, this started long back. This festival is, completely dedicated for women, and women across Telangana, get out to the fields, pick up these naturally available flowers. And they bring it together in the evening. They don't have to travel anywhere to celebrate this festival. Just outside their own homes, the traditional way of Telangana. I mean, this picture showcases the traditional way of celebrating Telangana. They dig a pit just opposite. I mean, outside their homes, and then everybody, all the flower decorations, what you see, every household brings one bunch of her own artwork and places it there. And it's a simple game of playing around the flowers. And then after the folk dance is over, they're all very happy. Like for at least 1 hour or 2 hours, they celebrate it in the evenings, where any women, even a kid until a grandmother, everybody, if you look at them, they're all very happy. For that part of time, they just forget the entire world and they celebrate themselves. And after they play, they put these flowers inside the pit. And then they close it. And, also on the 9th day, they take these flowers and immerse them into the lakes. So the scientific value of this is these flowers contain some of the, features in them which purify the stream water. So, it has, now we are speaking about so much about sustainability and all, but, there are so many aspects well within our culture which we need to explore and understand. So to promote this culture, in 2018, we did a Batukama ride. So we went to 9 districts of Telangana, 9 of us women on bullets, completely dressed in the ethnic wear. Of course, we had our safety guards, but it was a 1,200-kilometer ride, exploring our culture, tourism, and handlooms. And when we do these kind of things, we can also promote this more on digital media or digital content and let others know, what is there within India. India is just not about, I'm sorry to say this, but India is just not about Goa and Delhi, but there is definitely so much more. And I'm sure just like Telangana, every state has its own cultural festivals. We can talk about Holi, we can talk about Chhat Puja, there is so much, and our own Kolkata Durga Pujas. So, if we as Indians, and especially if we as Indian women, travel towards these places to explore the culture, and thanks to social media, if we can showcase it, then we women do it more. We send a message out there to the world that Indian women do enjoy living their lives, and there is so much more to explore within India. So this was one of our trial. I'm sure there are so many other women who are watching this presentation right now. I encourage you to you know, please explore your own cultures and show it to the world. And let's leave a very positive note. So, you know, Candida has taken you through excellent pictures, but I know a lot of you would be thinking that, oh, it's all very nice and, you know, fancy to look at those things, but how do we do this? It is, you know, very, very simple. Both me and Candida, you can take us as examples. Both of us are, you know, simple girl next door. We didn't have anybody in our families who would have done these kind of, adventure trips or something. We just got up one day and we said, okay, we want to, you know, explore our own country. What can we do? And we just went ahead. And today we have explored so many places, not just within India, but also outside. All this happens from home. So, you know, and for us to do these kind of things, the only thing which takes is a little bit of planning, because, you know, if it's a one day trip, you can just go out and enjoy the way you want. But if you really want to go to some best destinations, it will take some time and energies. If planned well, you can always enjoy it in a better way. Of course, planning doesn't mean that, you know, especially in adventure trip or trips like this, planning doesn't mean that, you know, you have to write so many things in your book and just stick or get fixed to that part. But, you know, it always can be, you have a plan, but once you reach there, even if things go upside down, you know what to do next. So, you know, planning always helps. And the first thing, if you want to do, if you want to travel across India on a motorcycle, especially, is pick up your map, pick up your destination, like whichever part of the country you're coming from, decide where you want to go. If you want to go to Ladakh, or if you want to go to Spiti, you want to go to Northeast during mountains, just pick up that spot on your map. That gives you how far away you are from that particular destination. Thanks to Google Maps and so many other kinds of maps these days, the world is at our fingertips. You know, all you need to know is how much is the distance. Is it 1,000 kilometers, 2,000 kilometers, 3,000 kilometers? According to that, you fix up your dates. So, you know, if you're traveling on an average, I would suggest, there are people, and even we would have done 600, 700 kilometers in a day. But I would suggest, if you really want to enjoy the space, you know, you can keep it to 100 kilometers or 200 kilometers on a short trip. And if you want to do long trips, especially if you want to go to Ladakh or Spiti or anywhere, you know, little far away from your own place, you can drive, you can use our excellent highways to drive 400, 500 kilometers per day until you reach that destination. And once you reach that destination, you can just do 50 kilometer or 100 kilometer. So put up an Excel sheet, figure out how many days would it take for you to go there and then come back. And sometimes you don't really have to travel all the way to the place and then come back. Let us take the example of, any place in Northeast. You don't have to literally drive from your own hometown until the place, because ultimately you want to enjoy Northeast. Of course, if you have enough time, you can travel slowly and go. But when time becomes a limited resource, if you just have 10 or 15 days, you can just fly into places like Kolkata, hire a bike there, and then just travel across Northeast in 15 days, come back, leave your bike and, you know, come back. That would save you another 10 days, extra 5 or 10 days. You know, you can plan like that. And then when it comes to budget, having the destinations and the number of days will give us, a little bit of information about the budget as well. So to travel within India, you can travel with a limited budget of 2,000 rupees per day per person to or 5,000 rupees. And it all depends on the comfort level you would want to have. But 2,000 is really good enough. 1,000 rupees is for your fuel. 1,000 rupees is for you to have a basic accommodation and great food. And you don't have to worry about the food at all. Across India, any roadside dhaba, you'll have excellent food. And especially the best thing is to stop by at a dhaba for a lunch, have your good food. Jitna bhi khao, you know, you can have how much ever you want. The bill will still be around 200 or 300 rupees max per person. And the food is definitely of very good quality. If we would have gone on a 30-day trip or a 20-day trip, and if we are physically perfect and being able to do that, that's a clear example that, you know, the fresh food is always good. And what happens in these dhabas is they have these nice cots just outside the dhaba. And after a heavy meal, you don't want to get onto your bike and drive. You can just park your bikes and, you know, take a nice nap, refresh, and then get back. And unlike what people would say, oh, Dabas is a trucker's place. We can't stop by. It might be not safe. But for us, favorite places are Dabas. We just park our bikes, sleep nicely. And all the Daba owners, when they see women driving and coming on their bikes, they will try to be extra courteous to you. They'll give you a blanket. They'll try to put the only one fan they have in that Daba to give some fresh air for us. And of course, there are good facilities wherever you want to stop by. And in the nights, you can pick up any hotels. Across India, we have fantastic tourism hotels in our Road to Mekong trip. 8,500 kilometers we have traveled within India, all the way from Hyderabad to Manipur and then back to Delhi and then to Hyderabad. So it's like one half of India we traveled, and everywhere where we were in India, we stayed in tourism hotels. And that was actually a luxury for us. You know, when we ride on roads, we don't want to spend a lot on the hotels, and our tourism hotels are really fantastic. I'm not saying this just because it's a tourism webinar. We have lived through it. And for us, reaching the hotel was like, oh my God, we can just have great bed to sleep on and, you know, good food to eat. So budget part is that you can definitely do it with 2000 rupees per day multiplied by how many ever days you want to do. And then comes to the accommodations. Like I said, we do have a lot of accommodation facilities, unless you are going deep into the nature or to locations where there are not great infrastructure. So those kind of places, especially when you're in the forest or some mountains or somewhere you want to explore within your stay, you can carry your own tents and you can just pitch it and stay. Just make sure that you have the permissions to pitch your tents. You know, within the forest also, the officials do have a segregated area for camping. So you can always camp. And I was on a Kedarkanta snow trek, the winter trek. And, you know, we had beautiful camping facilities. You can just open your tent and just look at the mountains and then just sleep. You know, we have great facilities. And one request is all of us should know that, you know, when we are trying to explore on our own, leave the space as clean as you have seen it before you reach there. So, you know, carry your own tents, carry your own garbage, take back your garbage. And especially if you're going on a motorcycle, you have enough place to bring back your own garbage and put it in a proper disposed place. Don't leave anything in the mountains. These are beautiful. Today, if we are, so happy exploring the mountains, it is because somebody has left it clean. Imagine if you mess it up, nobody would like to go back and, you know, explore the mountains. So we need to leave it clean and neat for the people who would come back and explore it later. And this picture is from our Bikerni, the all-women motorcycle club of India, which Urvashi was trying to show in our video. She'll talk more about it. But this was when they first, in 2011, a bunch of 11 women riders went all the way to Khartoumla and they set a record. So, you know, these things can happen. They are very easy. Just focus on a little bit on planning so you can enjoy your trips. And then I'll come back to the other road safety. So, you know, normally when you're traveling, all you have to do is figure out your places and know whether how safe it is and, you know, what are the timings where you can venture out and all those things. But on motorcycle, it becomes extremely important to give, very high listening to road safety as well. Especially you can see me and Candida. I think even it goes the same with Candida. We have ridden more than 1 lakh kilometers, not just in India, but outside. But all our trips were accident and incident free. That is because we gave highest importance to road safety. The first and foremost thing would be the riding gear, irrespective of whether you're riding within the city, outside the city, or, you know, somewhere in the mountains. The riding gear is an absolute necessity and a quality riding gear. It's just not any riding gear. Especially when we are doing short trips within the city, all we focus is good boots and a good helmet. But if you're going on long expeditions, which are more than 1 or 2 days, it's definitely suggested that you have a very good riding jacket with all the protective gears built in, and riding pant, riding boots, and gloves. So normal boots are different from riding boots. All these riding gear will protect you in case of any emergency. So, you know, and it's also very, very important to follow all the traffic rules. You know, within India, we have the same road safety rules wherever we have to follow. Unlike in some countries, there are some deviations, but within India, everywhere it's the same thing. Follow the traffic rules and set an example. Because people, when you are riding as a motorcyclist and exploring places, like Candida mentioned, there are so many places where people just stop by to see a biker going or, you know, crossing their path. They think like, oh my God, these are like astronauts having so many things, especially with our hydration kits and all. They just think that we are aliens riding in their villages. So, you know, when you go there, you also, when you are following a proper road safety rules, you're also leaving, unknowingly, you're encouraging a lot of people to follow these traffic rules as well. One important rule is when you are riding a motorcycle, it does happen for every 25 kilometers or 50 or 100 kilometers, depending on the weather condition and how much you have eaten. You know, sometimes you tend to feel sleepy while you are riding. And when the landscape is a little monotonous, especially when you're riding on the state highways where the landscape continues to be the same for 100, 200 kilometers, that time you tend to fall sleepy. So the best thing you can do is you don't have to stop by for a long break. You can just pull up your bike onto one side, stop it, wash your face, take a 2-minute break, remove your helmet, take some fresh air, and then get back onto the road. It's always important to take that break and ride rather than just continuing to reach a destination. And also, like I mentioned, taking breaks is really important. You know, when you're on a long ride, you please take a break at every 75 or 100 kilometers. Or when you're on a short ride and covering mountains, we take a break even at every 10 kilometers. So depending on how your body is coping up, you need to listen to your body and take breaks. And of course, wherever the scenery is there, wherever landscapes are there or any monuments en route, we will anyways take a break and enjoy that. So, you know, also, another important thing is about the breakdowns. So luckily, we have so many motorcycles in India which you can just pick up and go anywhere. You know, you can easily do a 10,000 kilometer trip with any motorcycle, irrespective of any brand. And but the one thing what you need to look out is before you go on to a trip, make sure your vehicle is completely, you know, gone through a perfect service. Tell the mechanic that or the workshop guy that, you know, I'm going on this kind of a trip. So they'll ensure that everything is perfect. Even after doing all those things, once I remember I was doing a Kanyakumari to Kashmir trip. It was an 8,000 kilometer trip. And suddenly my silencer came off. It just, you know, broke down and fell on the road. I had no clue, you know, because that is not something you would want to change just like that. So for whatever reasons, it broke down. So immediately I logged on to the phone to check where is the next available showroom. So it was after 50 kilometers. So we tied with the bungee rope. We tied it because it was silencer. I could still tie it to the other part of the bike. And then we slowly continued. But one good thing is everywhere we have workshops available. So you don't have to literally worry that, do I know, how do I fix my bike? Little bit if you know if what is the problem. You should be able to at least identify what is the problem with the bike so that you can reach another point where somebody can help you. So that is one thing. And moving on. Like Candida said, leave all your worries at home. India is an incredibly safe place for women, and we need to talk about this more positively in all our communication, wherever we do. Of course, I do understand there are incidents here and there, but 99% we are safe. I can tell you, both of us are real examples. We have traveled in India left, right, and center over the last decade. It's not that just one trip of ours, but we keep exploring in India every year. Like, I was very fond of visiting Kashmir and Kerala, both from the longest of my times. And I ended up going to Kashmir during when the floods came to Kashmir. And I stayed there without knowing anyone. I stayed there for 15 days, helped them. And now I have a family in Kashmir. Whenever I want to go to Ladakh, I make a fixed stopover in Srinagar. They help me and my friends figure out the logistics and we go there. Again, in Kerala, it's the same thing. So, you know, you go to any state in India, it's definitely safe. We are all here as live examples sitting with you. And if somebody says that India is not safe, please try to talk to them and get them out of it and make it, you know, try to leave a positive note. This is a picture from one of the Royal Enfield does a Himalayan Odyssey where it's an all-women trip exclusive to Ladakh. And these are the bunch of women just sitting out of nowhere in Ladakh. You know, what can happen? Nothing can happen. Just have to take a little bit of precautions. And India is definitely a much safer place for women. And we are seeing a lot of women bikers coming up now. And we are exploring so many, you know, unexplored places within our own country. So I think with this, I would like to thank Rupinder ma'am for giving us this opportunity. All of you can freely connect with me or Candida whenever you want, because I know 1 year, 1 hour is a very less time to talk about our country, especially when it's so huge with so many things to offer. And we'll try to play the other three videos separately, apart from the presentation, because somehow the audio is having a problem. So I'll leave it to you, Rupinder ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Jay Bharti and Candida. I cannot thank you more. You know, and when you thank us, I say thanks to all of you for bringing our incredible country to the viewers, not only who log in from India, but viewers who log in from other parts of the world. Truly, truly an incredible country, and truly presented so beautifully by two incredible women of our country. So many questions have come in, and I also, as always, have so many reflections to make, not only about incredible India, but not only about the women of India, but about the whole, you know, the heritage and the depth of our country. And we've spoken about the Atithi Deva Bhava. We've spoken, and I'm glad, Jay, you're mentioning that you have a home in Kashmir now, that you went there. And I'm sure we can all recount such experiences of being so very welcomed to homes of people who we have never met before. So some of the most specific questions, though, either of you can take them. The four-wheeler convoy of women travelers, is there any such concept of organized convoys, and how can people access information of tours going out for women only?
I can take this. So there are, like I said, unfortunately, we couldn't play the video. So Hema was trying to talk about the Himalayan Odyssey. So Royal Enfield does a exclusive Himalayan Odyssey every year, where you have a convoy, like they have a vehicle to carry your luggage or a support vehicle. Then they'll give you all the bikes. You don't have to invest. You can just rent it out, or you can bring your own bike as well, whatever. But those kind of trips are available. Then there's something called two-wheeled expeditions in Delhi. So they also do these group trips. Usually a group is between 15 to 20, and they look up for those things. There are a lot of motorcycle expeditions curated especially for women. It can be a combined trip as well, but there are a lot of options available for women-only trips.
Thanks, Jay. Candida, you took us around the different parts of the country, and a lot of viewers have questions around the stay part of it. That how are the stay arrangements, and how much of homework should they be doing before they head out for these tours?
So when I travel, I usually, because I have all the time in the world, so I usually open my Google Maps and like check which is the closest destination I can go to or how I'm feeling that day, and I ride. And when I reach that place, I usually then go and find a place to stay. But I request other people, if it's like a shorter ride, to plan better and choose the place of stay in advance. But sometimes they don't really work out when you're on a motorcycle ride, because anything can happen. Your motorcycle can break down. You might meet an interesting family on the road and they would invite you to come and stay with them. So that is why I don't really plan. I usually take it day-wise and as it comes. But there are a lot of websites, and the tourism board has a lot of stay options. So that is also a thing. But like Jay said, that we carry our tent and sleeping bag and stuff with us. So even if we don't find a place to stay, I would always like stop by a dhaba and like put up my tent and stay there. So that is just some options.
I'm sure Candida and Jay, you will agree that in the planning part of it begins the journey. So, you know, so when I'm sure when you're crafting out the itineraries, places to stay, the kind of rivers or the mountains, things that you're going to see on the way, adds to the whole part of the journey. The journey begins while you're still at home, viewers. So do plan and do join the Incredible India. Through, as Candida said, the Incredible India's own website, we have a lot of information for you there. And the state governments also have their own websites, and there are so many ways to get. All you need is just that little intent and that little will. But somebody is asking that, do you require a special license to ride in the mountains?
I can take this. No, you don't need, you know, if you have a valid license from any state in India, as long as you're traveling within India, you don't need any special license. All you need is a little bit of practice also, in the sense, you know, there are so many people who directly end up at Leh. If they just know how to ride a bike and manage your own bike, that's good enough. You really don't need to have any extra licenses for that.
Great. But I would like to add that a few mountain places require permits, but those are available once you reach the destination, and there are like small check posts, and you get the permits in a half an hour or like the day prior. So a few places, like a few places in the Northeast and Ladakh would require permits.
Okay. And I must add on that, viewers, that India has more than 120 peaks that are open. However, we must also remember that for a lot of people who live in those areas, they worship the peaks as goddesses. So it's important to go along with the local traditions and respecting the local customs. And that therefore also brings me to another aspect on which Jay Bharti, you touched also on that, on the concept of the responsible traveler. Viewers, the earth is beautiful. Our country is beautiful. It is blessed. But it's important for all of us to remain responsible and not just keep it the way it is, but make it more beautiful than the way we inherited it. Would you like to add a little more on that part, Jay Bharti, on how we need to be a responsible traveler? You did talk about it, but I want you to push that a little bit more for all of us.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you. I mean, I'm glad that you wanted me to talk more about it. Yeah, because in most of our travels, like I said, and like you mentioned also, the best part of traveling is half of it happens while planning itself. We read so much about it. We want to go there. We want to see it. But, you know, because we are reading so much about it and we are going, there will be millions of people who would want to go there after we go, especially when people like Candida put up everything on social media. People would think that, oh my God, this location is so damn good. I would just want to go there. But imagine if he or she ends up coming to a dump yard. What right do we have to make it a dump yard? Like, I first went to Ladakh in 2015, then again in 2016 as well. And then I've been visiting a lot of other mountains as well. So most of the times what I see is, of course, when we are traveling as adventure travelers or regular hiking and all, because we are a limited group of people, be it a group of 5 or 10 or 15, it becomes easier for us to look around at our own surroundings and see that, are we throwing something there? Are we keeping it neat? Are we carrying it back with us? Or the first thing is, do not carry too many things which you want to throw in the mountains. That's the first step. Don't carry things which you cannot bring back. Right from your water bottle, we usually carry a hydration pack, which is a bag which goes with us and comes back with us. So that itself will negate, let us say, some 20, 30 plastic bottles of water. And especially when you're going to mountains, be it Ladakh or Spiti or even in Northeast, they do have smaller cafes and restaurants which will allow you to fill water and drink. Like, you know, you don't have to buy mineral water in the mountains because the stream water is so good. You can just sometimes directly drink. I was at Valley of Flowers. I just drank the water directly from the stream and nothing happened. So, you know, it is clean. It is neat enough. Follow whatever precautions, but do not throw any kind of garbage. One is garbage part. The second is the accommodation parts, especially in these kind of unexplored places. We do not have great infrastructure. And we also do not, I think you would agree with that. In a development phase, you don't want to, break down the existing tradition or culture of that place or the natural terrain. Some places you can't build fancy hotels. You will love to go live there in the homestays. In Ladakh, there are so many women-run homestays. Even in Northeast, there are so many homestays. So when you go there, don't expect luxury. If you want to enjoy being a part of their families, please respect them. Follow what their rules are. Ask them, especially in India, most of the homes, people would want you to leave the shoes outside of their homes. And especially when we are riding a motorcycle, our gear and shoes are going to be extremely dirty. So leave it outside the home, treat it like your own home, and then take back whatever garbage. Again, I'll say, whether it is your own clothes or, you know, whatever you're doing, just bring back all the garbage. Don't exploit the place there. So it's an attitude we need to develop, that wherever we go, consider it as your own, like you mentioned, ma'am, consider it like a temple. You know, you're going there all the way because you love that place. So if you love something, how can you spoil it? So, you know, I would like to leave it there.
Thank you so much for that very heartfelt and a strong message going out to all the viewers. And not only about being responsible travelers, but also about the safety for women. Both those messages are very, very important from today's session. Those are our significant takeaways. And typically and normally, while we don't mention the names of, because it's impossible for us to mention the names of all the people who joined, but I must make mention of today of two of our viewers who've, a lot of you keep echoing that sentiment, Mr. Uday Iyer and Mr. Giridhar Reddy. I mean, sometimes when your sentiments and your emotions come back to us in forms of question answers and feedback, and I'm reading it as I am speaking, viewers, that truly, sare jahan se acha, Hindustan hamara, is being said by one of you. And the other one has said that, I don't understand why I should travel out of India after seeing so many incredible episodes. And they're thanking you ladies for showing a lot of beautiful pictures of our incredible India. Viewers, that's the sentiment we need to develop. This is our home. Incredible India is our home. I may have been born in city X, Y, or Z, but this is my home, and we need to own up our home and go and visit the various nooks and crannies and the beauty of our country. But do it responsibly and leave it even more pretty than the way you found it. But also, we need to empower our own selves to make sure that we showcase the beautiful India. And I think the women of India have been doing a remarkable job. It's just that sometimes I think we don't get recognized in a more organized fashion. To do that, the Ministry of Tourism is bringing to all of you the Incredible India Tourist Facilitator Certification Program. I have mentioned about that earlier. Viewers, it's for all of you to join. You do not have to be in the organized industry of tourism. For a mere 2,000 rupees, you enroll in an online program. You're empowering yourself to showcase that little place to someone. Your home could be a homestay. Your home could welcome somebody who enters your home is a stranger, but by the time the person leaves, he or she is your friend. I think that's the kind of community binding, and that's the kind of community spirit we need to all engage with in our incredible country. And while this episode was brought to you by women, but it was not only for the women. And I'm so glad for all the comments we got from the men. And at this juncture, I do want to say a few things. I have mentioned that earlier. Every woman who awakens courage in herself is Durga. Every woman who awakens transformation in herself is Kali. Every woman who nurtures in herself devotion is Parvati. And every woman, we mentioned that in the food episode, who nurtures is the Annapurna Devi herself. So the women in India have so many facets and so many beautiful sides to them. And therefore, Candida and Jai Bharati, thank you so much for bringing a very different dimension of women and telling everyone how women in India can travel safely to the remotest of locations. Candida mentioned about the fisherman and herself being all by themselves in a boat for 2 hours, and that experience has stayed with her. Viewers, let's create those memories. Let's create those beautiful engagements with our own people. I will, before we end, Jai Bharati, I will ask you for your one last statement, and Candida, from you, one last statement, a message you want to leave for all the viewers.
Thank you so much bringing up this session, especially. There were 3 other women, like I said, Urushi Patol. She started the Women Only Bikers Club from Pune in the year 2011. So right from 11 women then to more than 5,000 women, we have chapters across India, and we are, you know, encouraging each other. Like you said, women are all the Navdurgas in our real lives. We have been encouraging that sisterhood, and we'll be more than happy to encourage any of you, because I saw I didn't get time to see the question and answers, but a lot of questions were coming up on how do we join. So we have all these women only clubs, And Hema Chaudhary is there from Royal Enfield. They conduct the women only.
Hi, my name is Hema Chaudhary. I'm part of the rights team, Royal Enfield. We've conducted two editions of Himalayan Odyssey. It's an all-women Ladakh expedition. And it's a ride wherein women could participate without any inhibitions or could simply enjoy riding without having any feeling of peer pressure. Now, I understand a lot of us do not feel any such pressure irrespective if you're riding with men or women. But I also know a lot of us who do. So as part of the Himalayan Odyssey Women 2018 specifically, 12 of us rode for 18 days through one of the most treacherous terrain that the country offers. We started from Delhi and we rode all the way to Khardumla, covering more than 2,400 kilometers. And it's an amazing feeling to be riding to such a beautiful places, and especially with women who are as passionate as you are. And I've led a couple of rides in the past, but I have to highlight that I haven't seen that level of support, understanding, and a sense of camaraderie before on any other ride. And it's a great feeling to be part of such a brilliant group. And I firmly believe that the ride has been a transforming experience for a lot of us, and provided the much-needed gateway for the traveling. It instilled the confidence and created the desire to travel more and ride more. And we can see the impact of such a ride when you're out on the road. And especially as we, you know, start announcing about upcoming editions, the increasing participation, the increasing number of inquiries only indicates that we have more and more women, you know, trying to come out and trying to travel. And even the one who was sitting at home and asked, you know, have a lot of questions, would come to us and asking questions about, you know, how do you start? How do you get there? How do you travel so far? So you know that you really impacted them in a certain way and have really, you know, created that desire to come out of the house and travel. And in fact, even on social media, when we release the videos after we do the ride, you have more and more women asking questions and engaging and, you know, just finding the ways to come out and travel.
Odysseys. Then we have one special person, Onenti from our own Nagaland. She's a Nagaland tourism ambassador, but she has picked up, she explored her own state on two wheels so much that she figured out that I want to showcase my state to the rest of the world. So she picked up a motorcycle, explores, and today she's the brand ambassador of Nagaland tourism.
Namaste, my name is Onenti, Managing Director of Nokongur Naga Society. I'm a biker, musician, and a brand ambassador of Nagaland tourism from the Northeast India. My experience as a brand ambassador for Nagaland tourism cannot be justified without talking about how blessed I am today. And I was brought up like any other girl from Nagaland. Like, I attended good schools and colleges and also to achieve what I wanted academically. And the passion for writing came up to me 5-6 years ago, and to be bluntly honest, pursuing my passion is what led me here today. And you know, the God has been so good to me. You know, I got a job that I wanted, but I decided to leave my job and follow my passion, you know, to meet women and then youth and then share my stories and get to know their stories as well. I was part of the Royal Enfield Himalayan Odyssey Woman Edition 2018, and it was one of the biggest game changer in my life. And then gradually I got this urge to travel and discover my own land with my own bike, and I was privileged that I got support from my whole family, my friends, and also from the government to pursue further for my mission. Right after my solo tour of Nagaland, 14-6 days, the government gave me this opportunity to be the brand ambassador of Nagaland tourism. And to this day, I am still discovering new culture and imposing new stories, and I can't wait to share it to the rest of the world. And my dream is to travel the whole of India and then empower youth and women.
activism. The reason why I'm mentioning is, each of you have innate potential within you to do whatever you want to do. Professionally, I'm an architect, but the day I realized I like traveling across, and especially two wheels, I never turned any stone. I mean, it is sometimes very difficult to plan and be able to do it. But every year I promise myself that I will go out on my motorcycle. I don't get a break every week. So I put up those 10 days, 20 days or 30 days. And every year I go. Irrespective, if you are passionate about something, just do it. Continuously. Passion is not something like hobby where you just do it for once and then stop. Like if you like playing shuttle, you might play it and stop once in a while. But if you're truly passionate, continue doing it over the period of time. Let it be there with your life. And that not only helps you do that particular trip, but also changes you a lot as an individual. You know, you need to unleash the potential you have in yourself. And forget the obstacles. They will be a part of life. Whatever you do, example, COVID, we are all doing very good. 2020, we thought it's like vision 2020. Everything will be so beautiful. But we are all stuck at homes doing nothing. But still, we are happy or we are able to do these things. So, just be passionate.
Thank you, Jay Bharti. Candida?
Yeah, so like Jay said, it's all about the taking that first step and believing and achieving your dreams and just going out there and experiencing what this beautiful world has to offer. But also the biking community in India is so close-knit that if you need help about anything, planning, executing, or even if you need help while you're on the road, if you approach any of the groups, help will come to you within a few minutes. And yes, we encourage more women out there to pick up a motorcycle and start exploring when things get better. That is, there's so many groups like the Biker Knees, the Royal Enfield Himalayan Odyssey, and there's so many girls out there that you could approach and ask them to teach you how to ride a motorcycle. But now since because of the COVID situation, a lot of us can't really travel international, so that gives us the opportunity to explore our beautiful country, maybe not now, but when things get better. But just work hard, believe in yourself, and just explore.
Thank you. So work hard, believe in yourself, stay safe, be responsible. The country is beginning to open up, and with some restrictions and some suggestions on how to keep yourself safe, very soon we shall all be traveling. You could ride a bike, or you could be a pillion rider too. You could walk it, you could cycle it, you can car drive it, you can take public transport and go and just walk in these beautiful places. There's just so much to do in incredible India. And as to the videos, viewers, we will attach them to the recording that gets posted on the Ministry of Tourism's website. For technical issues, we were not able to run them, but they will be available as the repository goes for the Dekho Apna Desh Siri webinars on the Ministry of Tourism's website. Do visit the websites and do share with all your friends, both in India and out of India, the beautiful images of incredible India. I'm going to thank you all at this juncture for joining us today. And we are going to come back to you next Saturday on 11th. And we are going to bring you some more elements from Uttarakhand about yoga, the yogi way of life, and how to just live with a more sustainable model and yet have a fulfilling life. So some interesting snippets coming on 11th on that. But in the meantime, satark rahiye, swasth rahiye, apna dhyan rakhiye, jude rahiye, bane rahiye hamare saath, aur dekhte rahiye, dikhate rahiye, Atulya Bharat, our incredible India. Namaskar. Thank you, Jay Bharti. Thank you, Candida. Thank you, viewers. Thank you, NEGD, for letting us come back to you every single time. Thanks for encouraging us. Namaste.